Well, it's time now to revisit our virtual source model. We've been discussing this throughout the course. This has sort of been a unifying thread. We've been looking at it in deeper and deeper ways. And in this lecture, we're now able to explain the full virtual source model and in a way that we can feel comfortable in using it to describe nanoscale MOSFETs. So remember, we started the course by showing how easy it was using traditional semiconductor concepts to describe the linear current in a MOSFET and to describe the saturation current in a MOSFET. And then we developed eventually what we called a level one virtual source model, which smoothly connected the linear and saturation regimes, also smoothly connected the subthreshold and above threshold regions once we understood MOS electrostatics better in unit three. Okay. This is the form of the level one virtual source model. Again, still all based on traditional physics. So, and this is a model now that you're familiar with. We then moved on to the transmission model, which gives us a much sounder physical basis for understanding electron transport in short channel MOSFETs. We described the linear current, and we wrote the linear current in a way that it looked very much like the traditional current, and we could do it by introducing this concept we call the apparent mobility. We did the saturation current. We wrote it in a way that looked very similar to the traditional model. We introduced a velocity we called the injection velocity, which again had a sound physical basis, but kept the form of the equation very simple and consistent with the traditional expression. So now we can easily take our virtual source model to the next level. And it's very simple. All we need to do is to replace the diffusive model by this, the diffusive mobility by this apparent mobility. The apparent mobility is a combination of the diffusive mobility and the ballistic mobility. Very, very short transistors, the ballistic mobility dominates. Longer channel length transistors, the diffusive mobility dominates. We take the high field saturation velocity and we replace it by the injection velocity. The injection velocity depends on what the transmission is in the saturation regime. If the transmission is one, we approach the ballistic injection velocity. If the transmission is smaller, we achieve a smaller on current than is the upper limit possible. So our level two virtual source model is virtually identical. We simply replace the high field saturation velocity by this ballistic injection velocity. We replace it in the drain saturation voltage. We replace the Vsat by V injection, mu n by mu apparent. And we have two well-defined parameters. We have the same number of parameters in our model. We just now have a sound physical basis for understanding what these two parameters mean physically. So our transport at the physics at the nanoscale, we now have a better understanding of how all of this plays out in short channel lengths. I'd like to just say a couple more words about transport in the linear regime and transport in the saturation regime, just a couple of different perspectives on what we've discussed. So in the linear regime, it all involves an apparent mobility. And the apparent mobility is a combination of the diffusive mobility that involves the mean free path for backscattering in the bulk, and the ballistic mobility, which involves the channel length. Now, this particular way of combining mobilities, some of you will have seen this before. It looks like Mathiasen's rule. And it is frequently used in bulk semiconductors when you have two different scattering processes. So you combine, say, lattice phonon scattering with ionized impurity scattering, and you want the net mobility due to these two processes. In our case, we're combining a mobility due to scattering and a mobility due to the ballistic effects and getting what we're calling an apparent mobility due to the combination of those two effects. Now, I could write the apparent mobility in terms of an apparent mean free path for backscattering. If you were to equate this definition to our other expressions, you would find that 1 over the apparent mean free path is 1 over the actual mean free path for backscattering in a bulk semiconductor, plus 1 over the channel length. So that's sort of intuitive and easy to understand. An electron can never go further than the length of the channel without scattering. Whichever is shorter, if the channel length is shorter than the mean free path for backscattering in the bulk, then the channel length dominates and we're in the near the ballistic regime. If the channel length is very longer, then the mean free path for scattering it due to scattering processes in the bulk is shorter and it dominates. So this is an intuitive way to understand what happens as channel lengths get shorter. Now, we also have this saturation velocity, injection velocity, which is related to the transmission under saturation conditions. And we can understand that also. Because remember, the transmission is mean free path divided by mean free path plus the length of this critical bottleneck region in the saturation bias conditions. So if we put these two together, we can rewrite this expression this way. Saturated current is width times charge times 1 over the unidirectional thermal velocity plus 1 over diffusion coefficient divided by length to the minus 1 power. So this quantity is the units of velocity, all right? D is just my diffusion coefficient, thermal velocity times mean free path for scattering in the bulk divided by 2. All right, how do we make sense of this result? Well, let's look at an energy band diagram. Our energy band diagram looks something like this. We're focusing on the region near the virtual source, the region where the electric field is low, where the potential is strongly under the control of the gate. That region has a length I'm writing as little script L. And for those of you that are familiar with bipolar transistors, this will look something like the base of a bipolar transistor, where electrons have to diffuse across a base. So if it helps, you can think of that as the base of a bipolar transistor. We could think of this high field region near the drain as like a collector of a bipolar transistor. There's a large electric field there that sweeps anything across, anything that is able to diffuse across this low field or base region. So this is our bottleneck region, this region we have to diffuse across because the electric field is low. And what our expression says is that 1 over the average velocity in that region is 1 over the injection velocity plus 1 over the diffusion velocity. D over length as the units of velocity. It represents the average velocity of electrons diffusing across that region. So this is actually, I point out that this expression here is actually an expression that people developed for bipolar transistors in the 1970s because bipolar transistors with very thin bases were already available in the 1970s, and these kinds of ballistic effects were important already in the 1970s for bipolar transistors. So the way to think about this is that there are really three velocities involved. Electrons are injected from the source into the channel at the unidirectional thermal velocity. They're equilibrium electrons. They diffuse across this thin bottleneck regime at the diffusion velocity, D over the length of that regime. And then they get swept across the high field collector region at a very high velocity due to the strong electric field there. So there are three processes in series. You know, what velocity dominates? Well, it'll be the one that's the slower. The slowest velocity will dominate and control the performance of the device. What we've been assuming, and it's a good assumption, is that the electric field is so strong and the velocities are so high in this collector region that it doesn't limit the current. What the current is limited by is the first two processes. It's limited by the velocity at which electrons are injected into the channel from the source and the velocity at which they can diffuse across that bottleneck regime. Whichever one of those two velocities is the smaller will dominate. In the ballistic limit, they diffuse across that region so quickly that the injection velocity becomes the ballistic injection velocity. So that's our physical interpretation of these two quantities. And we have now completed our understanding of this MIT version of the virtual source model. And we've seen how you can develop it with traditional concepts, but you can get an understanding of what's going on inside the MOSFET if you recognize that we shouldn't be thinking of this as the traditional mobility This is really an apparent mobility that properly describes transport at the nanoscale. We shouldn't be thinking in terms of a scattering limited velocity in these very short channel devices, because scattering does not limit the velocity. We should be thinking in terms of a thermal injection velocity, and we've learned how to think about that in physical terms. So we have our virtual model established. You know, what's next for the course? Well, the next thing we would like to do in Unit 4 is to show how we can use this virtual source model to analyze measured characteristics of modern transistors and to deduce something about the physical operation of those devices. That's our topic for the next lecture.